This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we're going to have an audio-only interview with Kevin Day. Kevin was the Operations Specialist and Topgun Air Intercept Controller on the destroyer Princeton during the Tic-Tac events in 2004 off the coast of Southern California, specifically just west of here a few miles. And it's going to be a very interesting interview. He's not going to be talking just about that incident, certainly a lot about that, but also about what has happened to his life since then. Because there's a fundamental principle that people so far haven't fully grasped. This stuff, when you know it's real and you see a UFO, changes you almost as much and maybe as much as it changes you when you have an actual physical close encounter with the visitors. It turns your world upside down. And that's going to be happening to a great number of us all over the world over the next few years. A great number of us. We've been built, set up rather, I should say, for this. And now it's happening. Before we go on to Kevin and to the audio, unfortunately, it was simply impossible to do video because of his bandwidth issues. But before we go on to that, I would like to talk to everyone, subscribers and non-subscribers, very, very seriously about this website. Most people listen to or watch the shows without doing a thing about it. They simply take it for free and that's it. And that's fine, but the problem is I'm getting to the point where I desperately need support. I need people working with me. I can't do this all alone. I can't. I do it all alone too right now. I create the shows. I produce them. I set them up. I do everything. I need an assistant, and I've got to pay someone a living wage for that. I can't do it otherwise. And in order to do that, I've got to get more subscribers. You can't sit back and just enjoy this and not support it. So please, if you're not a subscriber, take me seriously. And if you are a subscriber, tell your friends about the value you find here, because it is a lot of value. Now let's go on to Kevin Day and a whole new way of thinking about the power and the effects of contact, and even about what it is. Look up in the sky. You may find your life changing. Today we're talking to Kevin Day. Kevin is a retired U.S. Navy operations specialist and Top Gun Air Intercept controller. He was the radar operator who initially detected and eventually intercepted the Nimitz Tic-Tac UAPs in Southern California in November of 2004. But that's not the end of this story. This story begins there, because Kevin looked at the visitors, and it looks like somebody looked back at him. Kevin, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley, and listeners. It's an honor and a real pleasure to be here with you today. Believe me, it is.
Well, why don't you tell us, just we've probably all heard the Tic-Tac story, so you don't need to, but this is from the horse's mouth. This is from your own personal experience. What happened exactly?
Yeah, basically, I was very senior at the time. I was I was enlisted. Enlisted ranks go from E1 to E9. I was an E8, a senior chief at the time. It was my, and unbelievably, this was my third ship in that, in those waters. I had literally years behind that radar in the Southern California operating areas. This was my last underway in uniform. I was getting ready to go. As soon as the ship got back to port, they were going on deployment. I was transferring off the ship. I was going to go work for the Admiral at Commander Naval Air Station Pacific in Coronado. And I was a trainer, you know, and all of a sudden I noticed these odd tracks off the coast of Catalina. And the reason why I say they were odd, I'd never seen anything fly like this. We tracked them coming from low Earth orbit, and they originally went down to 80,000 feet. And when I say they appeared in groups of 5 to 10 over the course of about 10 days. Anyway, they came down from space, stopped about 80,000 feet, and then they dropped from 80,000 down to 28,000 feet right off the east coast of Catalina Island and started tracking about 100 knots south. And they tracked all the way down the coast, and every single group disappeared right above Guadalupe Island off the coast of Mexico. Now, we weren't really concerned about them from an air defense point of view because, you know, we have data links and we were reporting the contacts back to the beach and everyone was watching these things. Although there was nothing published, we thought it was civilian related and they didn't even know we were out there. So we continued to track and report them. We didn't have any aircraft on the carrier at the time, so we weren't really worried about them. Until the day of the 14th, we were going to do a major air defense exercise. We had unloaded the air wing on the carrier, on the Nimitz, and I was the designer for the air defense exercise. We were going to launch a bunch of notional good guys off the Nimitz, a bunch of notional bad guys off of San Diego, and we were going to go at it in the sky. And at that point, those objects that were in our skies were going to become a major safety concern. So Captain Smith comes down to combat and says, "Hey, sir, you know, we've been watching these objects, whatever they are. We've run diagnostic tests on our systems. Everyone in the strike group's tracking them. I'm convinced they're real. I think we had better intercept one just to make sure we don't run into these things because we're going to get in trouble if we do because we were so incurious about them." He said, "You're right. So your chief intercepted the VID." And I was like, "Hell yeah," because that's exactly what I had wanted to do. So Commander Strieber, being the type of guy he is, one of the best darn pilots the Navy's ever produced, he was the first one off the carrier. We took control of Fast Eagle Flight, sent him up to the closest contact. And as soon as he gets to the merge plot position on the radar, which is basically two objects in the same vertical piece of sky, looks like one contact now on the display, that object went from 28,000 feet down to the 50 feet above the water in 0.78 seconds. Which is stunning. We didn't know what to say. Complete silence on the radios. Commander Favor's like, "Oh my God, oh my God, I'm engaged. And he's screaming on the radio. He goes chasing it down to the surface. He leaves his wingman up high. And as soon as he gets down by it, this thing recognizes him. It turns on him and it does a little dogfight with him. And according to his words, it disappeared right in front of his aircraft. That's exactly the way he described it. And on radar, that object, whatever it was, went from where he was in less than a couple seconds back to his combat air patrol station. The baffling thing is, it went exactly to the latitude and longitude and exactly the assigned altitude position of his assigned station in space, you know, in the sky.
Which he would return to.
Like, how in the hell did that, how did they even know where it was? And what? It was baffling beyond belief. And there's still no explanation for it to this day, as far as I know. Anyway, go ahead, Whitley. You wanted to ask something?
Yeah.
Say something.
Yeah. How fast in terms of miles per hour did it descend? Do you know?
It's been calculated about 35,000 miles per hour. No sonic booms.
That's really awesome. And Anyone who would have thought that that was like Chinese or Russian was just not informed. Because if they had something like that, this would be a very different world.
And, you know, I have to say right now, Whitley, my mind remains completely open about what this was. If it turns out to have been us or them, you know, terrestrial, I'll accept that, you know?
Yeah.
I'll accept that. On the other hand, if it turns out to be something off planet, I will accept that as well. My mind, you know, my whole job as a air defense and a guy that identifies stuff. I'm a trained skeptic, I was trained to never make an identification until I had the facts to do it with. And right now, I don't have the facts to make the ID, and I'm hoping to still gain them. And that's one of the reasons why we started our nonprofit. UAP expeditions.
Yeah,
and we're going out.
Tell us a little bit about UAP expeditions.
Yeah, we've been on three expeditions now, and I kind of removed myself a little bit to give them operating space. But I was on the first one. We went down to Southern California, and we have physicists from New York University, and we have a bunch of really high tech gear. And we took it out. We rented a beach house, and in Catalina was visible from the rooftop. You know, we could see it. And believe it or not, we detected anomalous objects in the sky. And a lot of your listeners aren't going to realize the significance of what I'm about to say, because I didn't myself. But one of the professors, Kevin Knuth, he says, "Hey, Kevin, come and look at this." I said, "Look at what, sir?" He said, "Well, I know you don't know what you're looking at, but those two spikes on that monitor are gamma rays." And he looks at me, he says, "I know you probably don't really know what you're looking at, but the odds of this happening, two gamma ray bursts like that back to back, are about 1,000,000 to 1.
Wow.
And later on, the other professor comes up to me, Matthew Zydalgas, and he says, "Hey, Kevin, I got a question for you." I said, "What?" He said, "Do you think these objects showed up just because we were here?" And he was dead serious. And I looked at him, I said, "I absolutely do. I think it's part of the phenomenon."
Well, it's very interesting.
Human intention affects these things somehow.
It's very interesting that you chose that particular area off of Catalina. But why did you choose it?
Because it's the proximity of it and the location. And, you know, that was the area that I first found the Tic Tacs on radar. The exact latitude, essentially. And longitude, you know.
Yeah.
In our, you know, we had a clear view to the western skies with all of our gear right there on the coast. Catalina right in front of us. I mean, it was like the perfect spot.
And you also, they were also tracked further south. Is that correct?
Well, yeah. I mean, back in 2004, over the course of about 10 days, these objects appeared in groups of 5 to 10 each, and if I added them all up, are you still there? I hear that blinging.
No, I'm hearing you.
Okay.
We didn't hear anything. We're fine.
Over the course of about 10 days, it was about 100 of these contacts, and every one of them came on radar off the coast of Catalina and tracked south, and every single one of these groups disappeared off radar right above Guadalupe Island off the coast of Mexico.
When you say disappeared off of radar, did they go into the water or just disappear?
They faded from my radar coverage. So I'm not sure if they were still at altitude. When they faded, they were not descending. They were still at 28,000 feet.
Oh, I see. So and it was an instantaneous end, or did a slower fade?
A slower fade.
How long did the fade take?
Probably 15 seconds.
Okay. I was just curious.
Yeah,
all right.
No problem.
Well, so here you are now, and you've got a group of people who are trying to find something. You said there have been three expeditions. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And so with three expeditions, there's been something found on the first expedition and not the second two, or? How does that
they've
work?
Found they have collected data on all three expeditions, and right now, in fact, Kevin Knuth and Matthew Zydalgas, our physicists from New York University, are doing academic papers that are going to get peer reviewed, and those are due out in the spring. So they're writing up academic papers on this right now. And by the way, when these papers are released, it is according to them. I'm trying to not talk out of school here, but I think it's going to shock the world when these things become public.
And these are people from New York University, not from Stanford or
New York University, yeah.
Exclusively?
They're physicists. They're physicists.
I see. And they're not from – I'm just surprised by the name of the university. I would have thought maybe Stanford or MIT.
Okay.
But how did they come? Well, you know, it's 15 minutes in. We have to take a brief break for our free Dreamlanders.
Okay.
So I'm going to do that right now. We'll just be quiet for a couple minutes.
You got it. I'll set the phone down and...
No, it's just 30 seconds.
Go check the fire, huh?
It's 30 seconds. It seems that in-person conferences are finally coming back. I'm going to be at the Conscious Life Expo February 4th through 7th at the LAX Hilton near Los Angeles Airport. It's going to be quite a conference. I'm going to be talking about my new book, about them, a deep look into just who our visitors are through the medium of what they do. It's going to be a very interesting talk, I can assure you. A lot of friends are going to be there. Jacques Vallée is going to be there. Jimmy Church is going to be there. George Noory is going to be there. It's quite a big group. Bashar will be there. I haven't seen Bashar in a long time. William Henry, Linda Moulton Howe will be there. All kinds of great people. Adam Apollo is going to be there. Alan Steinfeld will be there, all kinds. It's just a wonderful lineup of extraordinary people. So go to ConsciousLifeExpo.com and you'll be there too. We'll see you at the expo. I can't believe after all this time, I am finally able to say those words. The people who came forward and volunteered.
Correct. Yeah, they were the ones that showed up and volunteered, essentially.
How interesting. I find that all very fascinating. The website is UAPExpedition.org, folks. That's UAPExpedition.org. And you have a book out as well, don't you? He has a book out called Sailor's Anthology. It's just in paperback. It's not on Kindle even. Or maybe it is. Just on paperback. Only a few reviews. Very little few people have seen it. I don't think you've pushed it very hard, have you?
I haven't. You know, well, it's never been my goal to try to monetize this thing. In fact, it's just not what I'm about, I guess. But the whole provenance of that book is back in 2008, after I had retired, I continued to try to tell people, anyone that I thought would listen, of my safety concerns with these objects in the sky. My whole concern from day one was safety of flight. I was concerned about safety of flight of other aircraft because I knew these objects were real. But unfortunately, all people heard was UFO. That's all they heard out of that. And I got so damn frustrated, I ended up quitting my job. I went back to Phoenix, where I was living at the time. And I was like, what the hell am I going to do? So to get this off my chest, I wrote a short story about it. I fictionalized it because this is back in the day, people were still active duty. I wanted to protect people's identities. So I fictionalized it, wrote some other short stories to go with it, and I published it in the Library of Congress. The reason why I did that is just in case the story ever did become public, that my little book would become evidence that this thing really did happen. Years went by. I ended up back home working down at the golf course, volunteering, and all of a sudden the CNN story broke. And I was like, oh my God.
Yeah, finally, it's not fiction anymore.
Yeah. It's not fiction anymore. And all those people that laughed at me, they're not laughing anymore, I don't think.
I don't
think
so either.
They listen to Kevin.
I recall that one of the main debunkers, Seth Shostak, immediately said, oh, it was reflections on the cockpit windows.
Correct. Yeah. And this was one of the most senior pilots and most talented and gifted pilots the Navy has ever produced. And yeah, sure, it was reflections. Like, he's never seen those before, right?
Yeah, exactly. And he was, but it was on your radar. And that's not a reflection on a cockpit window.
Not just Princeton radar, but it was on the entire strike group radars. And also the airborne E-2 Hawkeye aircraft had it.
So it's been finally admitted that it's real, and the Pentagon is in hidden overdrive right now to deflect any chance whatsoever of actually having to produce the truth, which is going to be has been mandated by Congress at this point. So we'll see what happens.
Thanks to Senator Gillibrand. What a hero she is.
Senator Rubio, too. Right, I mean, it's across the aisle.
I know. This story has changed the planet, Whitley, somehow.
It's changed the planet profoundly.
Governments are getting into gear and they're realizing, hey, these things are real. Let's do something. Let's find out. And I think the tipping point was 2004. That really ended up changing the discussion of this thing. And it's okay to talk about now suddenly.
Right. And it is. And we've come a long way. We know somebody is here. We don't know exactly what they are or even where they're from or how that all works, but they are here. Now, I want to go back to the period after the event, when you began to have disturbing dreams. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, and this is part one of, and you're leading to the reason why I'm glad I'm here and I want to talk to everyone, is because when this started happening, I started off in Phoenix after I quit my jobs, and I started having disturbing dreams of astrological nature, like end of the world type shit. And I thought, okay, I'm just going through a transition and they're, you know, dreams are dreams. And I didn't really think too much about them. But you know what, Whitley, I became obsessed with an idea. It was like, and it was foreign to, it was like, what the hell? But as it turns out, my family back here in Southern Oregon, where I now live again, we had a family mining claim out in the wilderness, out in the Calmeopsis wilderness. We'd had it for 100 years, a little placer mining claim. We've kept it active. And I became convinced I could find the mother lode for some reason. So I ended up in the wilderness. My wife had left me. I was basically homeless at that point. I was almost out of money because I'd lost a bunch of houses in the housing correction.
Of 2008.
Everyone in my whole family was probably thinking, God damn, Kevin's gone crazy. He was on a path to retirement in Hawaii, and now he's in the wilderness doing what? But you know what, Whitley? And you were going to ask something. Go ahead. I'll pause for a second. You were going to ask me something.
No. Go ahead.
Okay. And so I started doing research on this thing, and oh my God, as it turns out, our little placer mine is actually related to a huge piece of geology. It's called the Josephine Ophiolite. And basically what that is, in the mid-Pacific Ocean on the spreading plates, where the earth starts spreading and those plates start moving towards continental plates, in this case, the West Coast. And, you know, those things are highly loaded with minerals because of the hydrothermal vents lay down mineral deposits. And normally those pieces of geology get subducted under continental plates, except for when an ophiolite happens, and then they get stuck on dry land. And that's what we have over there. We have an ophiolite stuck on dry land, and it also extends, and it's huge. It's absolutely huge. And I think it's loaded with gold and rare earths. And oh, by the way, rare earths needed for space exploration and new technologies that haven't even been designed or developed yet. And the reason why I believe that is because not only of our placer mining site, but right outside the boundaries of the wilderness area, there's a little mining operation called Turner Albright. And I don't know, when I did the research several years ago, it was worth about $110 million. over the course of 8 years. And so the whole thing is, time went on, and I recently applied to go on the Deer Moon mission, and I was actually ended up on a short list, although I'm not sure what my status is at presently. They haven't recontacted me. But about a week after applying for the Deer Moon mission, and I think I've sent you the images,
right.
I was outside the house and I noticed this weird jet flying back and forth right over the wilderness area, and in a place where jets never fly. I don't think they're allowed to. Back and forth. So I went back in the house, and a little bit later, one of my friends contacted me and said, "Hey, Kevin, there was a NASA flight flying in your area on a geodetic mission." So I'm doing the math in my head here, Whitley, and I'm thinking to myself, okay, was that Elon Musk checking out my research? Because, you know, Elon Musk is the one that's doing the Deer Moon mission.
Right.
And I don't have any confirmation of that, but it's pretty clear to me that's what happened. Or someone checked out my research, put it that way.
Right.
And
sounds like
it's still
true.
I think it's still happening. If I'm right about this, for lack of a better word, discovery, if I'm right about discovery, there could easily be enough mineral wealth there to, I don't even want to say it, but I will. There could be trillions there. Trillions.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And is there any interest in mining it at all?
Well, see, and that segues into Musk's likely interest in this, if there is one at all, because that it's all in the wilderness area, and the simple answer is no. And that's why, even if someone gave us permission to mine that wilderness, no one in my family would do it anyway, because it's a rare and beautiful place, and there ain't no way we're ever touching it. But because Musk now has this tunneling worm and boring technologies, that deposit might now be mined from below the ground without ever touching the wilderness above.
Wow.
Think about the
tunnel technology.
Yeah. Think about that. Wow, right?
Yeah. So you've changed a lot. I want to go back. We're going to take a little break now, folks, because we haven't explored a lot of things with Kevin. We haven't explored the dreams, for example, and what happened to him that took him from being a highly successful and skilled naval member of the Navy to defense work to homelessness. What happened? We're going to be right back, and we're going to talk about it. We're getting a little bit more deeply into those dreams. We'll be right back. Expedition.org. UnknownCountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past. And for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field. And when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system. It energizes the solar system as you have things going into the sun. Even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun. It will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age. In approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted, and this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. go to unknowncountry.com right now, click on the subscribe tab, get started. Org. His book, Like Majestic, a work of fiction based on fact, is called Sailor's Anthology, and it's available through Unknown Country. You can go to Unknown Country and get it, and get it also on Amazon. And before we left the air, briefly paused, we were talking about beginning to get back to those eschatological dreams, dream end of the world dreams that you started to have. When exactly did they start?
I was living in Phoenix at the time. I quit my defense industry jobs, and I was writing my short stories at the time for Sailor's Anthology. And it was around that time, 2009, 2010 timeframe, somewhere around in there. I no longer have them, by the way, just so you know.
Good, good. I'm glad. Yeah. I'm glad you don't. Did you have any sense of their, have you ever had any sense of the presence of the visitors in your life?
Oh, man. You mean like physically present with me?
Well, not necessarily physically. This is a very complex business. Physical is part of it, but not all of it.
No, I just, the simple answer is no. No.
Tell us do you remember any of the dreams?
The astrological type dreams?
Right.
Frankly, Whitley, I don't really consider that part of the story that important. In fact, I think the important part of the story is whatever this thing is, it's real. Governments have admitted that now. And we are not in control of it. When I say we, I mean humans on Earth. And the thing is, if any of your viewers, and some of them probably have, and they're going through the same type of things themselves, but for some reason, when a person encounters these UAP objects, it changes you. It changes you. I almost cussed, sorry. It changes you. Yeah, all of a sudden, you might have new abilities that you didn't have before. You might have new skills you didn't have before. You might have new interests. You might have new obsessions. And and if you don't know the reason why it's happening to you, it might not be an easy journey like it wasn't for me. I mean, consider this, Whitley. Just what if what happened to me suddenly happened to every person on Earth all at the same time? And everyone on Earth started changing and nobody knew why. You know what? That might not end so well. So I think the important point of this whole conversation at this point is to get the message out that, hey, whatever this thing is, it's real. And if you encounter it, expect to be changed by it. And don't be afraid of it. Embrace it.
That's the key, is embracing it. It's very hard to do.
Embrace it.
Yeah.
Embrace it. And I also think that's why this thing has avoided our planet for so long, because they knew this. They knew that, hey, if we contact them, it's going to change them and it might end in disaster. So they left us alone out of a love for us, I think. And why is it happening now? Well, your guess is as good as mine.
I think it's happening now because it has to happen now. Otherwise, it's going to be too late soon.
I think you're right.
Yeah. And that was why I was interested in the dreams, and why I do think they're more important probably than you do.
Okay.
So
I understand what you're saying. Yep. I got you.
Yeah. Now at one point after 2008, you begin to really suffer. You suffered PTSD and, you thought you had a psychosis. You know what that looks like to me? It looks like what happened to me and what happens to thousands and thousands of people after they have a contact experience, even if they don't remember it.
Right.
So where are you with that? I mean, tell us about what your mental state was at that point.
Tell us what?
Your mental state at that point.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I was in an adjustment period. I'd spent years in the Navy, and I just kind of assigned it all to my transition. This is what people go through, and it's just natural, and I'll accept it and move on and make the best. But today, I'm at peace with the whole thing. I truly am. I'm at peace with it. Why I was the one that found him on radar, and why I'm the one that, why me? I I've struggled with that for so long. When Commander Fravor came out in 2017, I had moved on, Whitley. You know, I'd moved on in life. I'd published my book years ago, and I'd basically forgotten all about this thing. And then it broke on CNN, and then I immediately ran out of the golf course. Hey, Dave, my brother-in-law now. I got to go home. I'll explain later. I ran home, and I get on the internet, and I pick up the phone, and I call Gary Voorhees, my old shipmate from the Princeton that was there with me. And I said, hey, brother, he's like, I know, I just saw it on CNN. And I said, hey, man, we got to stand up and support Commander Fravor. We can't let him twist in the wind all by himself on this. We were there, and we know it happened. And that's kind of how all that started. One thing led to another, and we ended up starting our nonprofit organization, and none of us are getting paid. It's all volunteer. And we want to make the ID. We want to figure out what these things are. Our mission statement for the company is UAP is real. UAP is findable, which we've proven both of those now. And UAP is knowable. And that's what we're working on now. We want to know what these things are.
I agree with you. I think it is knowable. I don't think they would be here if we couldn't understand. What would be the point?
Correct.
But it's going to be quite a leap to understand. And a lot of the people who have had experiences are going to be a big part of that leap. But you said something a little earlier that I thought was very telling. You said that the presence, the knowledge that this is real is going to change people. And I think you're right. I think it is changing people. I think it's been changing people who have been contacted all along, very much in the way you've changed. But just knowing it, not being in direct contact, how do you think that – what sort of changes is that going to bring about?
Okay, I'm going to speculate here because I don't have any evidence, but what I think happens, and I think it, I don't even say requires, but I think what's happening is when a person is in the presence of one of these objects, there is some sort of, and I think it's all physical. I think it's a natural thing that happens. I don't think there's anything spooky about it, but I think there's a certain frequency that emanates from these objects, whatever it is. Probably really high terahertz type frequency. And I think it changes the human brain in some way, and it allows the brain to become more of an antenna, and it opens up a pathway, and it changes you from there. It changes your brain. And you said, I mean, I've heard rumors that there's contactees out there that can suddenly speak a foreign language, and they don't know how it happened. And I'm sure you've heard the same stories. And that's just one example. This contact with these things changes you. You suddenly have skills and abilities and interests and passions and ideas you never had before. And how does that happen? And I think there's a physical explainable explanation for it. I really do. I don't think there's anything spooky about it whatsoever.
Well, I don't think there's anything spooky about it either. I think that we don't understand the way it affects us. You know, there was a study done in Great Britain in 1997 that was eventually declassified and released as something called the Condign, Condign report. I probably have it somewhere on my website, in fact. And it concluded that there was some kind of a radiation involved in being close to UAPs that could enable them to basically implant memories in people of things that didn't happen. But I'm not sure that the people involved fully understood what they were saying. they were saying, really, that it was that something that we can't detect is remembered. Not that it didn't happen. They thought it didn't happen, but I think it's that we can't detect this. And your dog obviously can, though.
Yeah.
Anyway.
If he barks again, I'm going to go out and walk
outside. Right. Well, you've gotten deeper.
Say it again. I'm outside now.
Okay. You've gotten deeper into the close encounter community since this happened. Is that correct?
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, I'm definitely a part of the UAP community. Yeah, you could say.
Why did you decide to do that?
It found me, I guess. I'm just a regular dude. I happened to be on watch that day when it happened. I don't know why then, and I didn't ask for this, Whitley. I didn't ask for this.
This is planet Earth. This is planet Earth you live on. There are no regular dudes here. That's not what this place is about.
That's funny. Yeah. Okay, I'm as regular as your neighbor, I guess. And I'm not. My whole goal right now is to let the world know that if you see these things, expect to be changed by it. Because if you don't know that and you start to change, it might not end well for you.
It almost didn't end well for you.
Yeah, damn near didn't. There was a couple times when I came close to not being here when I was back in that wilderness, just so you know.
Yeah. I mean, you went back to your roots. You were that troubled by what happened. Your whole life dropped away from you. Mm-hmm. And you didn't even have, at least not in your conscious memory, a contact experience.
No, I didn't. I at the time this was happening in 2000, the mid 2000s, right there, and then 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 time frame. I at the time did not connect the dots. I did not in no way relate what I was going through back to the 2004 incident encounters. I thought maybe I'm just, this is what happens to people when they retire, or maybe I'm going crazy. I don't know.
Well, of course, you weren't going crazy.
Thank God, right?
You went to the VA at one point.
Oh, yeah. They diagnosed me with a complex case of PTSD. I think they kind of threw their hands up too, to be honest with you. Yeah, so I'm 70% PTSD disabled, and 10% for tinnitus. So I'm like 80% disabled right now with the VA.
Yeah, I think a lot of us probably could be disabled. One of the things that happens to a lot of people in the close encounter experience is tinnitus. I have tinnitus too. You have to get. It's hard to get used to, folks, if you don't have it.
I got ringing right now.
Me too. I have it. I have 24 hours, seven days a week.
Yep.
And now let's go. Do you want to talk about the PSYOPs issue?
About how the visitors I had.
Yeah.
This was all first. Oh yeah.
Okay. Let's do this. Let's take a little break here.
Okay.
And we're going to say goodbye to our free Dreamlanders here as well. And I do hope you subscribe to the site because it needs you, and it's not getting much in the way of subscriptions lately at all. And if this is going to happen right, as it should happen, this whole huge thing, Unknown Country is going to be a big part of it, and so is this show.
Cool.
Yeah. I mean, like it or not, we're here.
Yep.
So yep. Hey,
just so you know, I've been a coast-to-coast listeners since it came on the air with Art Bell long ago.
It's been a long time.
In the Navy listening. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to take a pause here for our subscribers, and goodbye, Free Dreamlanders. I hope in the future you go to Unknown Country and subscribe and stay with us.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.